When it comes to generative design workflows, MEP workflows are often overlooked. In this video, we're going to show an example of doing AV layout, specifically laying out a camera object in a room in the optimal location based on viewpoints. So with that in mind, we're going to look at the graph and see what all it does. In this case, here's our sample graph. Our graph has inputs, some various sections that do calculations, and the blue sections are visualization. We'll go into each group briefly, but we break this down a bit clearer in the blog post linked below, but let's go ahead and take a look at it. The first thing that we have available to us is a select room node. This node is from a custom package called Rhythm. This allows you to work with linked rooms. In the case of a MEP consultant, they're more often than not working with a linked model. So that's why this node became a necessity. In this case, we have an advanced sample project linked in, and we can select the room in a floor plan view. So we can go ahead and do that. I'll hit select. We'll come in and we'll select a room. And we now have that fulfilled. In addition to this, we are in Dynamo 2.13, so we do have these wires hidden for these inputs. That is a feature of Dynamo 2.13. Our next input is the perimeter location. This is the location for the camera around the top of the room at a mounting height. So as you slide this, the camera will work its way around the room. That way we could start to see visibility from points. And you'll see that this runs quite fast inside of Dynamo, and we'll talk about that here in a second. Other parameters are the pan angle, so the left to right angle of the camera. If you tilt this, you can start to slide this around and see what the viewpoint would look like from that point of view. The tilt angle is the up and down angle of the camera, so you can slide this as well. And these values are bounded from 0 to 180, which is pretty typical. You can change those according to whatever your parameters are as well. A few optional parameters that are numeric input are the mounting height. The project I'm in is in imperial units, so it's at 8.5 feet where I want to analyze the camera mounting point. We have the horizontal field of view for the camera, the vertical field of view, and those are both defaulted to 90. You can change those though. So if I were to change this to, a lot of cameras are around 135, we'll get a wider view from that. So you can absolutely change that as well. In generative design, the latest version, you are able to use numeric input. So that's what's really nice about this workflow. In addition to these inputs, we do have another toggle in here called Enable Fast Display. This workflow uses a custom package called VASA, and that section's over here in these green sections. And what VASA is a voxel model package that lets you build voxel models from Revit models. And a voxel model is a model that has a whole lot of points and shapes in it, so it can do a 3D point model. We'll link below to Keen's blog post as well, where he really talks about the ins and outs of this package. I saw that it was available and that you can do visibility with it in a 3D way, and I thought it would make a perfect use case for something like cameras. That in mind, this same package and example can be built upon to do things like check the throw of light fixtures from a ceiling or fire sprinklers. You can kind of see what their throw's like. There's another node in VASA that's called visibility from cone, and you can define the cone, the throw. So that'd be a really cool use case as well. VASA is a great package, and it does a lot of things very quickly for these kind of analysis. With VASA, we have the ability to display the voxels in a really quick display, and specifically, this is called a voxel tessellation. So while we're sliding our slider, this is the fast display. By default, that's the one that we want to use in Dynamo. I tend to use this one in generative design as well, and we'll see in a little bit the difference it makes. But if we want to preview this in generative design at the time of this recording, we have to convert those voxels to cuboids. So that's also achieved through a custom package or from Rhythm to toggle that option. So in the case of displaying it in generative design, we do have to do the extra conversion to cuboids. We don't always want to do that conversion because it is a kind of heavy process. If I were to toggle this to false for enable fast display, you'll see that Dynamo has to think for a moment. It's still pretty quick. It's not super slow or anything, but the responsiveness is a little less. So you'll see as I make changes, Dynamo has to think for a moment. That's because we're dealing with quite a few cuboids that we have to color. So I'll go ahead and toggle this back to true for now. Within our background preview, you will also notice that we have a results section of text. This includes our fitness functions that we're optimizing against for this workflow. This includes the percentage of the room visible and if all of the doors are visible from that viewpoint. In this specific case, we have 21% of the room visible, and one of the two doors can be seen from that camera location. That section is in one of these blue sections. These are display sections, and it is being formatted and using a custom package called Dynamo Text. All the packages are included in this workflow in the dataset because generative design saves all the dependencies for us, which is really nice. But that's how that's achieved. That also uses a custom node from Rhythm to generate that preview text really efficiently using a formatting. For our fitness functions, those are achieved in these green sections. So we have the VASA nodes that are counting how many voxels are filled based on our analysis, and we're comparing that to the overall room shape as well. Within the room, we are taking out all of the bounding elements. So if I kind of pan and scroll around here, you'll see that we have boxes that represent the tables within the space, and we see those in the Revit 3D view. So we are taking all of those into account to see what kind of visibility we have. So if we had a really high table object in here, that would start to break apart the visibility, kind of like these columns are as well. This is meant as more of an estimation for what the view's like. So that's what makes VASA a really great package to use for this, because it offers that really preliminary estimate of the visibility. For our other fitness function that we're optimizing against, this would be our doors. In this case, we're seeing if the point of the door, the center point, is within the voxel model. So VASA offers nodes for that, and it really quickly lets us check that. So that's one thing we do have available to us and what we are using as an output as well. So that's a summary of all the nodes in this graph. So we'll go ahead and hit save here. And we'll close Dynamo and we'll take a look at the Revit model. So as mentioned, we have the advanced sample model linked in. I have a 3D view that's cropped down with a scope box. Scope boxes are typically used when we're working with sections of a model to be able to section them down efficiently. So that's what we used in this case. In addition to this, we have another object loaded in this model. So if I hit CM on my keyboard for component, you'll see that I have a little camera object. So I'll actually isolate it. This camera object's included in the data set as well. And all it offers are a few parameters to load our results into. So all of this work we're doing, we want to be able to store that somewhere. So in this case, we have pan and tilt within our camera object, and we're able to assign those parameters. So we'll see that when we run the optimization as well. All right, with that in mind, let's go ahead and go to define a study, and we'll take a look at all the inputs. In order to define a study, I'll navigate to the Manage tab, the Generative Design panel, and the Create Study button. As before, we'll see all the different study types available to us. In this case, I have my folder mapped. As a reminder, you are able to map additional folders through that Add Folder icon and map to them. In this case, I'm working on my desktop, pretty simple, and every Dynamo graph for Generative Design within that folder will show up for me. We'll go ahead and click on this to modify our inputs, and we'll see that we have a description, the author of this, and all that good stuff. In this case, we have inputs. I numbered the inputs, that way they would organize in the order that I wanted to. You can change that in Generative Design. If you were to change this from sort nodes alphabetically, it will sort them in order of creation. Alphabetically is pretty good though. We also have node descriptions and graph properties. So those are all available to us as well. We'll go ahead and leave the defaults. In this case, we need to select a room element. So if we were to navigate to the floor plan and click on select, it lets us select anything from that linked model. In this case, we'll hover over the room and we'll select that. And we'll see that we have a room selected now. We can see which element is selected specifically. Our next input that we want to allow generative design to work with is the perimeter location. So we want the camera placement to be able to work around the mounting height around the entire room and try out all the different variations for us. So that's what that first input is. The third input technically is the pan angle. So that's the left to right viewing of the camera. And that's typically 0 to 180. So we'll leave that checked as well. Same for the tilt angle. And new in generative design are the options to enter numeric input. So in this case, we have mounting height, horizontal field of view, and vertical field of view. I'm going to go ahead and leave these all as the default, but you can change these if you'd like. The last input that we have to modify is the enable fast display. I'm going to go ahead and deselect this as an option for generative design to use, and I'm going to leave it on true for the fast display. The goals are to maximize the percentage of the room that is visible and maximize the number of doors that are visible. So we want to leave those as set as default as well. These values were saved as default in this workflow. So just to reiterate, you can save default settings by clicking on the ellipses button and click on save default settings. And for this workflow, I'm going to go with a population size of 20. So that's kind of the first round of variables that we throw at the workflow. And then the generations are going to be how many times we iterate and refine. So this is where that process comes in that's generative. It starts to refine based on all those generations. So it gets better over time. These settings really produce a result that I like. I encourage you to check these out and mess with them as you please. We also have a few other methods in here. So we can do randomization. We can do a space evenly that gives us options from every combination of selected inputs. So there's a whole lot of options in here. In this case, this workflow was designed for optimization because I want one single point or a couple options that make sense to lay out this camera. With that complete, we can go ahead and click on generate and we'll start generating options. As a reminder, this is on the fast display. So I'll compare the speed of the runtime between each one towards the end of this video. All right, and now our run is complete, so we have some results available to us. In this case, generative design did present us with two options. They both look like they're from a similar viewpoint, but they have slightly different results, so let's take a look. So the first option we have hits both doors, so both doors are visible to an extent. So we can see where that is, and we can see all of the little view based on the tables. That's a really good result, and that one, about 52% of the room is visible. If we click on the other result, that one gave us slightly better results for the percentage of the room visible, but one of the doors is missed slightly more. But if we look at it, we can see that we're seeing right around this column, so that's kind of interesting. I kind of like that result, actually. In this case, I want to go ahead and try this result. So at this point, if we go ahead and scroll over, we have this Create Revit Elements button available to us. In the graph, we have a section in there that's a family instance placement section. It's protected with a gate node in generative design that prevents it from running until I click this button. So let's go ahead and click this now and see what happens. So in this case, it did create the camera object. So we can see that over in the corner of the room right here. And we can see that that's pretty much where we had it in the model. So you can see where that is in the generative design model. And if we navigate back over to Revit and I'll go ahead and select the camera, we can see that it's pointing that same way. The parameters are set at tilt angle at 56 and pan angle at 60. Those should be pretty much the same. Yep, those are the same as they are in generative design. So that's good. And that perimeter location is a number from 0 to 1 in generative design, but in Revit, that's an actual location within our model. So that's really cool. That went ahead and placed that camera for us, and that is a pretty optimal placement at this point. Based on our generative design model, we're able to see that we can see right past that column and so on. So pretty neat. Those values are now stored within the model for us. So that was the fast display option. I'll put the time that that took down below on how long it took to run, but let's go ahead and see what happens when we do the non-fast display option and what it looks like. So in this case, we're back in the create study dialog. I'm going to go ahead and pick a room once again. And all of the parameters should be the same. For a fast display, we're going to click on false this time, and we'll run with all the same settings. So let's go ahead and click generate and see how long this one takes. All right, now that one's complete. So we'll take a look at the runtime for that. But as you can see, this one runs significantly nicer in terms of how it looks. So if we were to zoom into the background, we'll see that we have some transparency to that view cloud now. We're able to see kind of through it and see that those furniture objects and where those would be. So it does give us that benefit. This is the way that we're able to see it in Dynamo within the background preview as well with FastS visualization. There is a known issue right now with FastS, so I thought that's why it was worth showing, that you do have to convert them to cuboids for them to be visible in this UI. That's one thing. When you're building graphs like this, you want to make them as accessible as possible for people to use them however they'd like. So that's something to always keep in mind. This UX or user experience is really nice though, because we're able to start to see through this visibility cloud. And you'll see that that's kind of mimicked here in this model. You'll see the tables and chairs, and now you can kind of see that those are occluding some of our views. So that is an option available to us within the graph. In this case, it only ran a little bit longer. I'll put the times down below. But yeah, that's another option that's within our Dynamo graph. Next steps for this graph would be to use that same point, so where this camera is getting placed, to use that same point to create a 3D view. Dynamo includes nodes for creating axonometric views from a point with an angle and view direction and all that good stuff. So I would encourage you to take this sample graph, build upon it, and maybe try to build a viewpoint from that view of that corner of that room. That'd be a really cool use case. In this case, I wanted to highlight placing a Revit element with parameter set and using the VASA package in a way that you might not have thought of initially. They built it to do a lot of pathfinding things and other workflows like that. Really great package to check out. I encourage you to check out Keen's post linked below. But other than that, this is an example of a MEP consultant, specifically AV, being able to use generative design to do a design task. That's something that would take you a little bit longer if you were to do that manually. Hope that helps out. Leave some comments below. Let us know if this workflow helped out, and thanks for checking out this tutorial.